For all the celebrations surrounding the first manned lunar landing of Apollo 11 in 1969, what is forgotten today is just how close they and the other Apollo missions flew to the edge of disaster. Apollo 11 came within seconds of aborting the landing because they had overshot the landing area and were running low on fuel. This was only one of several issues with the Apollo missions that arose that could have led to the loss of the mission and the crew, though as it turned out, only Apollo 13 came close to this actually happening. This does obviously exclude the Apollo 1 accident, where the crew died because of a fire as they rehearsed the launch on January the 27th, 1967. Apollo 12 was struck by lightning twice during the launch, and although it knocked out several electrical systems, the main navigation system continued to work and the rest of the mission proceeded successfully. On Apollo 16, the engine backup system malfunctioned on the command module as it orbited the moon, which resulted in the flight being one day shorter, but mission control determined that they could work around the fault instead of aborting the mission. Even Apollo 11 was just a test flight. It was building upon the previous mission's results and achievements. It was to be the first attempt at a manned landing and was driven as much by the desire to achieve President Kennedy's directive to put a man on the moon before the end of a decade as it was to beat the perceived threat of the Soviets getting there first. US national pride was at stake if either of these had failed. As Apollo 11 was to be the first landing, NASA wanted to make sure that it would be as event-free as possible, so they chose to land on the largest, flattest part of the moon they could find, officially known as Site 2, which was a 10-mile-long elliptical area in the northern Sea of Tranquility. The idea was that the flight computer on board the lander would guide it down from 50,000 feet to 500 feet above the surface, where Neil Armstrong would then take over the controls for the final landing. However, Armstrong became aware early on that things were not going to plan and that they'd already flown over the landing site and were heading to a boulder-strewn area now known as West Crater, about the size of a football field. He assumed control from the computer and manually flew over West Crater and another smaller crater before landing on the outer edge of Site 2, about 4 miles from its intended target, and uttering the immortal words,
"Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed."
As he was making the final descent, mission control estimated that they had just 25 seconds of fuel left at the time they landed, although this was later revised to 45 seconds after the mission. NASA's rules required that the mission be aborted if there were less than 20 seconds of fuel left, because if they didn't, there was a danger that they might not be able to perform an emergency ascent. To abort the mission, they would have to start an emergency ascent protocol, which would separate the ascent module from the lander, which they would then fly back to the command module. It would take between 2 and 4 seconds for the emergency abort to complete and the ascent engine to fire. All the time, they would still be traveling alongside the descent stage. If they didn't get far enough away from the descent stage, then there was the danger of any remaining rocket fuel exploding when it crashed into the surface, and the flying debris could hit and damage the escaping module. The other great danger of the mission was that no one really knew if the ascent module would be able to take off, as it had not been tested on the moon up until the mission. If this was the case, then the crew would be stuck on the moon. It's not known if the crew had suicide pills with them in case they were stranded, because there would be no chance of rescue. NASA did not have any standby rockets or landers ready. 30 years after the first landing, a previously secret memo was discovered at the American National Archives showing what NASA planned to do in the case of such an event. In the event of a worst-case scenario, NASA planned to cut communications with the stranded crew, and they would be left to die as they ran out of oxygen or committed suicide, something that the crew later said they had no knowledge of. Just 2 days before the Apollo 11 mission, Nixon speechwriter William Safire was tasked with creating a condolence speech that would be delivered by the president in the event of such a tragedy occurring. Unlike the Apollo 1 disaster, there would be no way for NASA to examine the scene close up and in detail to determine what had happened if the lander crashed on the lunar surface. NASA had discussed using one of the four remaining Ranger probes, which had six TV cameras on board. The Rangers didn't fly over the moon taking video. Instead, they picked areas to image and then transmitted the images back to Earth as the probes crashed into the surface. Ultimately, this idea was dropped in favour of using a Hasselblad film camera on board the command module, taking images at a low altitude of 10 miles above the surface. This would give a resolution of down to 1 foot, enough to see what had happened to the lander and if the crew were outside, although the commander taking the images would just have 10 seconds to locate and photo the scene from 10 miles above and travelling at orbital speeds around the moon. Luckily, no major tragedies occurred with the remaining Apollo missions, and neither NASA's final plan nor the president's speech were needed. And as always, thanks for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.